Good morning. Welcome to Asia Society Hong Kong's coronavirus update. And we are into episode 23. And today is September 22nd. And we are really delighted that 8 months still into the virus, we can still bring you updates from various developments and research. So before we get started, I want to give you kind of the overall number as well as Hong Kong's number. Overall, we're seeing over 31 million global cases. And Hong Kong, we just passed a milestone mark of 5,000. And the death is around 103, still quite low. And we're really delighted that today we have two experts to talk to us about something that we haven't talked about. We've been in for this episode, the various episodes, we've talked about the pandemic, we talked about the virus, we talked about the various testings. And we've talked about vaccines. And today we're going to talk about a really interesting tool or service that's mitigating the circumstances of the spread of COVID-19. We are very lucky here in Hong Kong to have these homegrown technology that we can share with you. We know the numbers, I think the US, India, Brazil, and Russia are top four that still are going through. And we're hearing in London, they may also have a major lockdown. And I know our colleagues in Melbourne are also going through lockdown. So here we're in Hong Kong, we send our best wishes to everyone outside and really count our own blessings. Hong Kong's community testing ended last week after 2 weeks with 1.78 million people tested and with about 32 cases detected. So that just shows you our Hong Kong number and we should be proud of our number, but at the same time, be really vigilant as I think predictions on the fourth wave coming in the winter might be even worse. So let's keep our fingers crossed. But in the meantime, I think this morning's program will hopefully give us some hope because of the technology that has been developed by UST, my alma mater, and also with the product we're gonna be talking about, or it's a technology. Germagic is a germicidal technology owned by Qianhua Industry Limited, and they are working in collaboration with UST, and we're really delighted to bring two of the experts. And today we have Hamilton Hong, co-founder of Germagic at Homegrown, as I mentioned, Homegrown germicidal technology brand, focusing on the long-term anti-epidemic control and disinfection. And he's a chief marketing officer and a chief investment officer at Jiahua Industries Limited, and has over 25 years of experience and expertise in biotech, consumer goods, and healthcare. And he's a graduate of Marshall School of Business at USC. And we also have Professor King Long Yung. He's the director of Hong Kong UST's CIL, Joint Laboratory of Innovative Environmental Health Technology. And he's a professor of the chemical and biological engineering department and the environment and a sustainability division of the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. So, and he obtained his PhD in chemical engineering from University of Notre Dame. So welcome to the both of you, Hamilton and Professor Yong.
Thank you.
Before we get started, I'm gonna turn the mic over to Professor Yong to give us a short presentation on on the project. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much, Alice. Okay, and I would like to thank the Asia Society for giving us the opportunity to do a sharing of some of our work at the HKUSD. Okay. So here at HKUSD, we have been working for quite some time on a family of what we call smart antimicrobial technologies, focusing on basically preventive, preventive technology to maintain a healthy environment. Now, the main situation is I found since returning to Hong Kong is the large scale infection events are actually very regular, in Asia. There's a epidemic and pandemic from H1N1 to SARS to now COVID-19. And then the other more scary thing is there's growing number of microbial resistance and tolerance, to existing treatment. Okay, and in fact, the worldwide prevalence of what we call antimicrobial resistant related infection are on the rise, and it's going to become a very, very big problem in the future. Now here at HKUSD, the way that we approach it, okay, is that we actually do fundamental research in the lab. And then once we get it to a certain point, we usually do clinical study, clinical and field study, because we find it to be very important to engage the major stakeholder to really understand not only what they need, but what do they really want, okay? Because if we only address the need and then not the want, okay, we will never, never close the breach between the technology. Once we get past this, what we call clinical and field studies, then we engage company. The company will then do third-party certification and productization, commercial development, which we would aid them with, okay? So the research that we had in this particular area is actually started in 2003, okay? That is during the height of the SARS. And this is when we rolled out the first technology, which is catalytic air sanitizer designed to actually kill 90% of airborne microorganisms, including viruses. Then in 2004, because like we were engaged by a sponsoring company, which have a good relationship with Beijing city government. And at that time, Beijing is trying to bet, okay, for the 2008 Olympics, and they are quite concerned that the SARS is going to be a recurring event. So they had a small think tank group that come up with a list, okay, of a specification for a technology that they would like to have, okay, technology that they don't have, but they know what they wanted to have. So the company shared it with us and asked us whether we would be interested in doing this. And then we basically said, yes, we would do it. And in 6 months, we come up with the technology. The technology is a smart coating that can last for at least 30 days, okay? And then that can kill about 70% of microorganisms upon contact, okay, within half an hour. So for them, that is sufficient. And that is basically the generation one. However, we know that SARS didn't happen again, okay? So that is good for the whole world. But for us, we are very interested in this concept. So we start investing more time, okay, and more effort. And then by 2008, when we have the H1N1, okay, pandemic, we are ready. So we roll out the first, like the, which is generation seven, that's why we call it germ-free seven, which can achieve very high 99% bacteria in 1 minute. 1 minute, okay, not 10 minutes, not 1 hour, but 1 minute, and also viruses, 99% in 1 minute. And during this time, we work very closely with hospital authority, with the Center for Health Protection, and also NGOs to test the technology, to really design it for the stakeholder. And toward the end of 2018, we actually come up with the first antiviral, okay, HEPA filters, okay, that can kill viruses, including MERS-CoV. And that is the time that we actually sign in the joint laboratory with the with CHIPWO, okay? So it's an industry academic partnership. And that enable us, okay, to have technology ready to roll out during the time of need, just like in COVID-19. In fact, the antiviral filter was used in Huixishan Hospital in Wuhan during the height of the COVID-19 epidemic in China. And more recently is the MAC-1 technology, which is now helping Hong Kong to cope with this really difficult time, okay? So the antiviral technology, we usually do a lot of testing, okay? A lot of the laboratory testing, third-party testing. And then simultaneously, we work with NGO, in this case, it's Haven of Hope, Christian services. We use them in their palliative care, okay, in order to really design it to be effective and also workable under their requirement, okay. So this is where we develop, and then that later on went to the hospital in Huixishan, okay. And more recently is the MAP1 technology. The MAP1 technology was officially rolled out sometime in March, okay. So that was the technology that is currently that we are deploying heavily here in Hong Kong. So this technology is actually designed, okay, not only to kill the very infective viruses, the one that we usually see, the measles, mumps, and rubella, the very difficult to kill, okay, viruses or surrogates like feline calicivirus or MS2 phages, but they are actually recently tested for human coronaviruses, and even more recently by Microbac for SARS-CoV. So they can actually achieve 99.9% or what we call more than 3 log reduction within 10 minutes of contact with this material. So this is showing that it is very effective. Why is it effective? Because the design of the technology is like we basically target different biological compartment using different route, attack route, okay? So it do contact killing, it do release killing, it do anti-adhesion. And through this process, we basically physically damage, okay, the viral capsid, which basically the viral shell, okay? So exposing the virus, basically killing them. We disassemble the viral spike that caused them to infect cells and even break down the DNA and RNA of the viruses. So by doing this way, you know, recently there are a lot of reports that shows like SARS-CoV is very difficult to kill. You know, people have been using nano spike to kind of try to break it like and they cannot do it, okay? And then they even expose it to very high temperature, 60 degrees for an hour. They can survive it, 100 degrees for 10 minutes. Think about it. You usually don't cook that long instead of doing it stew, correct? But this one is designed to actually target different biological compartments so that we can disinfect very quickly and very effectively. So what is it made out of? It's made out of polymer. So it's very safe, okay, polymer material. Some of them are already used in your cosmetics. Some of them are used in food product. It's only the way that we assemble them, okay? It's just like, you know, a piece of steel, you can use it in a rocket ship or you can use it in a bike. It depends on how you engineer and basically shape them. So it actually do anti-adhesion in addition to killing, okay? And it's very effective not only to viruses, but to many of the bacteria that is going to be a very big problem, not only for the hospital, but in the community, because some of these bacteria are drug resistant. There's no cure for it or very difficult to kill, okay? So this actually, as I mentioned, a lot of our technology, we field test it first. So we have done a 7-month study in Kowloon Hospital, okay? Use it in partition curtain because they find out the partition curtain is very much contaminated and there's a lot of hospital acquired infection is caused by those, okay? So they had tried many different product, commercial product. They had tried many different technology from other university, but they find that they don't really fit their needs. So this is the one that we developed for them. And it worked very well, it's long lasting, and it can actually reduce MRSA, which is a drug resistant bacteria by close to 98% after 3 weeks, okay? 3 to 4 weeks that it is hanging there, okay? And it can last for, the technology can last for more than 20 weeks, okay? So currently the MAP1 is marketed to last for 90 days. So germagic thyme in Hong Kong have been used quite extensively with support from both the community, from other sponsor and government, okay? So they are used in more than 1,000 public school, elderly homes, 6 of the universities, 2 of the public hospital, more than 300 public clinic, post office public, okay? Vending machines, retail outlet and other places. And from my understanding, it had also been used outside of Hong Kong, which Hamilton can give more sharing later on. So I will stop here, okay? So thank you. Let me remove my sharing.
Thank you so much, Professor Yong, for that really interesting presentation. And one of the first question I have is, and you know, a lot of us, what are some of the side effects? I mean, the concern is it sounds very effective, you know, market for 90 days, but what are some of the possible, you know, the generally the stuff that a lot of consumers are worried about really is the side effect, if there is any, of using this product?
In fact, this is study because like, as you can see, we did part of the study in the hospital. Before we can get into the hospital, we had to do a lot of safety study. So some of the safety study that we have done are on cells to make sure that they are not actually have acute toxicity. They don't kill the cell. They don't have cytotoxicity or even genotoxicity. That means to say it doesn't cause mutation on the gene. And then the next stage is like we also did animal study, Okay, so in the animal study, we do it in the rat. So we look at the effect on the skin. And then we do volunteer study. So we look at, because like in the rats, you can only observe whether there's any irritation on the skin. But on volunteers, they can actually provide you direct feedback, okay? So those are stages of study that we have done before we go to the hospital. So we had to ensure that they are very safe. The other thing that we make sure that it's very safe is that all the components that we use are actually already approved by either US EPA or US FDA for other uses that are related to food or drug, okay, or supplements, okay, so to ensure that they are very safe, okay.
Great. I want to kind of remind our online audience so they can submit questions on Slido, and the code is 8881. So please, later on in the second half, we will answer questions. And I'm curious now to ask Hamilton, how did this partnership with Jianhua came about with UST? And it sounds like it's the research has been on for a while since 2000 or beginning in 2003, but how did the partnership came about?
Hamilton, yeah. Jianhua itself has been a business conglomerate in Hong Kong for the last 80 years. And we have been working very closely with most of the university in Hong Kong through a lot of bursaries and a lot of education subsidies. So to us, we are no stranger of working closely with the university. And approximately 20 years ago, we start developing into the water purification business and also the air purification business. That's why we start working with Professor Yang and his team data back in 2003 to start deploying, try to find the best technology out from university and through some licensing arrangement to commercialize it. And it has been a long process, yet fruitful process in the last 17 years. We have in different phases able to pick out the best from the university and commercialize in different products into the water purification, air purification, and now in also into the anti-pandemic fight against the COVID-19.
So one of the questions for both of you is really, we talked about SARS, I think in Professor Yang's presentation. In 2003, SARS hit Hong Kong in a spectacular way, but it was very short-lived. But I think it sounds like the lessons, I know in my conversations with the other professors from Hong Kong UNC UHK, SARS really is kind of this defining moment for Hong Kong's research. And so on the biotech side of it, can you kind of talk about a little bit of that from I think CIO's perspective as well, UST? Kind of also, I think Professor Yang touched upon the importance of research. In some ways, it's kind of nice to know that when the time came in March, you could have, there was a product and service available to help, mitigate some of the issues. So if you can, either one, you talk about the SARS journey, in particular with CIO, it sounds like the company, you've been here for 80 years. Hong Kong has always been very congested, and you talked about the work in water and air purification. So I guess the importance of SARS for either of you. Professor Yang?
Yeah, okay. In fact, the collaboration with CIL predate to 1999. Okay. The first project that we did with CIL is actually PCO, okay, photocatalytic oxidation. Okay. So as I mentioned, like the one thing that I have heard, okay, is that the tremendous change in attitude after the SARS. There's a many change in terms of habit and behavior, especially for Hong Kong. Used to be like Hong Kong, when you get sick, they will never wear a mask, okay? So that is one of the biggest change that I had observed, okay? The other thing that I observe is like people observe hand hygiene a lot more, okay? They tend to be much more accepting, even though they are very skeptical about new technology, okay? So that kind of opened a door for us to work with the hospital, okay? Because before that, most of the old school doctor would say like, whatever doesn't kill you make you stronger. But I said, well, this definitely gonna kill you, correct? So at that time, they changed their total attitude and outlook regarding technology and emerging technology. And that gave us a way to really cater to their needs, okay? By understanding what it is. You know, for example, does anybody knows that usually a disinfectant that you have outside, like they said, it kills 99%, but there's one parameter that they don't tell you, how long. So some, like for example, bleach need at least 10 minutes. So that's why you need to spray the surface with bleach and you have to let it there for 10 minutes in order for it to reduce that amount of bacteria, 99%. They always doesn't tell you that amount of time. So some of the bactericidal carpet, they are benchmarked 24 hours, okay, to kill 99%. So if you need to go to the hospital, they need something that is almost instantaneous. So some of our benchmarking is 30 seconds, 1 minute, okay? So these are the benchmark. Now, third-party certification, they cannot do that short because like their standard is 10 minutes. That is the shortest time that they would do the testing for. Okay, our technology, we knew we cater to the hospital, so we need something that is very quick. Okay, because you just clean a surface, the next person touch it, definitely is gonna contaminate it, all right? Because there's no residual disinfection, okay? So that is the problem, there's no residual, okay? Even in water, okay, we accept the technology that we need to have residual disinfection in water to keep it pure and safe. How cannot we accept that for surfaces that we touch, okay? So this is something that I said, okay, for water, it's something that is required, mandated by law. You need to have this residual disinfection. Now, how can we carry some of that into surfaces, okay, to provide longer term, okay, protection for people? So that is basically the driver for us, okay?
Hamilton?
I think for the 2003 is a big turning point, although I actually joined the project at a later stage. But in our side on the commercial development, we always give us the alert and say, if that happened in 2003, what if it's happened 1 year, 2 year, 5 years later? So it always give us in the high alert mode when we develop the product. But of course, it has been 17 years since the product has been developed. And in certain stages, we have to keep try to do some twisting in terms of, well, if the actual spray is not accepted by the public, what if we can turn it into other development? Because we remember we talk about we develop in water purification and air purification. So we need to keep focus in the last 17 years and keep adapting the different technology that Professor Young and university developed and put it into perspective, because at the end of the day, we are still a commercial organization. We need to make sure that we have to make the balance between spending enough and supporting enough in the research. And on the other hand, at the commercial organization, we have to get something out on the commercial side to make sure we sustain, have adequate income to sustain supporting the university of more research.
When I was reading about the first time the application was issued was with the Hong Kong Sports Institute, I understand, in April. So, and that was a major scale, that was the first. And then I think Professor Young also mentioned in his presentation about the importance of the Olympic in Beijing in 2008. How, they didn't know what they want, but they kind of know what they want, but they didn't know what product, and then was able, I think the product sounds like was able to be used. So right now, my question is very much about the Olympic in next year. Any goals of, with 2021 Tokyo, because that's when, a lot of athletes going to gather. And so what are some of the plans for 2021, if there was any for the Tokyo Olympics?
Yes, indeed. There was a discussion between us and the sports institution. And right now, actually, I know Professor Young and his team has been working about expanding this technology into textile. So we'll be looking at the possibility of gearing up all their sports apparel with not only just antibacterial but antiviral coating on their on all the clothing on their sports apparel. That has been discussed, but at the very preliminary stages. But we believe in the next 3 to 4 months, with more research data, testing data that's available to us, we'll be able to come back to the Sports Institute to propose a possible prototype of the products.
Oh, that's interesting to learn. I'm fascinated because even with the mask, I think Professor Yong is so right. Hong Kong, unlike Japan, we were never used to wearing masks as much as Japan, and you know, and then now all of a sudden it's really our everyday accessory, and even companies are now making it, textile fashion companies are making it. So it's really good to hear that it is being integrated into either with a sportswear or whatever we, you know, in the future. So I feel better already. But one of the questions that I want to ask before I turn it over to the audience is really, I understand, in fact, the museum, I think, Hamilton, you had sent me a message about the uses at some of the public spaces and museums. I know Hong Kong museums, we've been closed. Many of the museums have been closed for about 2 months or so. So how has it been used now by some of the public places that you have, Professor Yong have previously mentioned?
I think the development has been very promising since April. And you just mentioned about the museum. In fact, over 15 public museums in Hong Kong are now adopting the MAC1 technology, especially the Science Museum, because they are right now, starting tomorrow, they're going to have an exhibition, which the MAC1 technology will be part of the exhibition as well. And particularly Science Museum, because first of all, it's where all the Hong Kong science starts. And especially a Science Museum, when we do the deployment, we feel a big blessing, because Science Museum is one of those museums which involve a lot of high touching point. So when the student, when all the what the audience coming in, they actually touching everything. So it's very important to make sure that we have this coating in place all the time. And in fact, we recommend doing at least less than 90 days to do the more deployment. And for us to be able to help out in this museum is also it's a big blessing. In addition, we also work with the post office, obviously post office and it's another area which including many, many interaction. And we also now working with the Food and Health Service Department in terms of doing the coding in all the public toilet and the wet market as well. So our team has been doing very hard behind the scenes and doing a lot of these job, make sure that a lot of these public places in Hong Kong are safe and with the coding in place.
And you mentioned earlier that you said the all KMB buses have been using the coding. Is that correct?
Correct. All 4,300 KMB buses, which including the airport buses, has been deployed with the coating. We started the project back in late July, and by now I'm very happy to say that all the buses already with the coating.
Not yet the MTR?
The MTR, we have a plan in place with MTR. They want to first adopt it into the high-speed train station, but obviously, as you know, the border hasn't been totally open yet. So they plan to do it a few weeks before the high-speed rail station reopen.
And I'm curious, Professor Yong mentioned that the product was also used in Wuhan as well in the recent, you know, can you tell us more about that, Professor Yong?
Yeah, this is on the antiviral, like the air filters, okay? Because at that time, when they start to realize that the COVID-19 is actually communicable through air transmission instead of like direct contact, then they started to look around for technology that can actually be effective against like the coronavirus. And since this is the only technology out there in the market that have been rated for MERS. So that is why they were very happy to adopt it in the Ho Sing Sun Hospital in Wuhan Okay, I think Hamilton can give you a little bit more information about that.
Well, that back in late January, we in close communication with the Guangzhou Institute of Respiratory Disease, that the one led by fellow Chung Nam San. Mm-hmm. And at the time, they are building the Hao Shan Shan Hospital. And actually, our relationship and working collaboration with the GZIRD has been on for the last 10 years. So we knew each other very well. So at the time, they received a lot of donation of the air purifier. But fellow Chung Nam San understand the air purifier is only going to mitigate part of the problem. The air purifier itself, particularly the filter, can only trap the viruses and the bacteria. But potentially there's a lot of chances for second contamination. So they remember when they did some of the research and the test for us 3-5 years ago, the understanding our filter with Professor Yang's invention, the coating, will be capable of killing the viruses. Particularly, we did the MERS test 3 years ago. So they particularly asked for whether we can support. So within 2 weeks, we are able to ship about 20,000 pieces of our cold filter, and we ship directly to Hao Shan Shan Hospital. So they can put this filter inside the air purifier, kind of like upgrading the air purifier to become an air sterilizer. And that's in place until recently. So.
So is that also available for now residential? Because it can, and you know, people who have some of these filters at home, can they also acquire that for their homes?
Oh yeah, actually this product has been commercialized and it's available in a lot of retail point right now in Hong Kong. And it's very easy accessible. Consumer actually can buy, we so-called a stick-on filter, and then doing a DIY approach and then apply it on their home air conditioner, and as well as an air conditioner and dehumidifier to add a layer of antiviral capability on the existing unit.
Right, because I think I remember there's been a lot of studies about the droplet from the air conditioning from various restaurants and so on. So I guess if the restaurants or many of these public places use that filter, that will also bring down the spread, sounds
like. Yeah. Well, actually, we did some pro bono project. We donated a lot of these stick-on filters to some of the primary schools before the school actually restart in May. And in August and until recently, we also donate a lot of these pieces directly to the school so they can install it on the air conditioner.
So I think for those who are interested, I think on your website, I know there are numbers to contact. And so I would encourage some of you to look it up. Germagic, I think Google it. I think I found the website really fascinating in terms of the information that you have. But right now, another question I have, and right now there's something, we have some questions from the online audience, what other countries have used this product so far? Is it just only in Hong Kong and China, or has it been exported or plans of exporting?
For sure, Hong Kong and China is using, but in the last few months, we have actually getting into a country like Singapore, Malaysia, recently Bangladesh, Mexico, and also Philippines. And Brazil, we are working on some compliances because some country, when they treat disinfectant, you have to go through a very robust application process. You have to go through the health administration of these certain countries. So we are working hard to get it going. And we also have a lot of requests from Middle East, US, Canada, which we identify some partners and we have been working on it. And recently we are working also with 7 different African countries right now at the moment.
Okay. And are you collaborating with the governments or has it been enterprises, or the business on some of these projects?
It's a combination of both. In some country, for example, Pakistan, we received the official request from the government and the Ministry of Health that they want to work with us directly. So in along the same line, there's also mainly will be with a commercial organization we will prefer to work with a company which have, for example, the disinfection business in the background, so they will understand the products better and help us to get through a lot of different certification and compliances within that country.
I wanted to ask Professor Yong this question. You know, in light of your collaboration and all this, also the stuff that we're hearing about vaccine, what Oxford University with AstraZeneca on the vaccine development, and how important do you think is the cooperation between private industry and academia, and in critical times like this, it sounds like the partnership that you talked about has been going on for decades, but times like this, when the crisis come, the product is there ready to serve. And in some ways, I people may credit it for how low our Hong Kong number has been. But how important, it's not something that's been done overnight, but it's been the collaboration. And I know UST and the other universities here in Hong Kong have been really forefront of this. But can you talk about how important this partnership is?
Yeah, I think like the partnership between academia is quite essential nowadays. Because one thing is like the academia always looking for a good problem to solve, correct? And then industry are looking for good solution. Now to bring both of them together, okay, that is really good, okay? Because one thing is like a lot of time in academia, we may be trying to solve problems that are not really there, okay? And then we are trying to address need that nobody really want, okay? To put in a perspective like the, from industry, it's very important if we wanted to have the technology really connect with the community and really make a difference, okay? Because as I always tell my students, it's like however good your technology is, but if nobody wanted it, it's not gonna make any difference, okay? You can say whatever you want, okay? But if nobody use it, then it's not really making any impact, okay? So working with Chip Wo, it has been a very long, steady working relationship for past almost 21 years, okay, since back in 1999. So it's a very steady relationship in a sense we come up with some idea, we tell them about it, or they come back with us with certain problem that they had, and then they are trying to find a solution to that particular problem. So this is a give and take, because sometimes we have a great idea, it might be able to solve this problem. Okay, so it's like doing pitch on both sides, okay? So it's a two-way street, okay, in terms of this relationship. The other thing that I find very important is like, for example, industry are much more, I would say much more alert in trying to spot bottlenecks, okay? Like for example, right now, everybody are rushing to make the vaccine, all right? Everybody are rushing to do the vaccine. But do you know the real bottleneck is not the vaccine nowadays? The real bottleneck is basically the delivery device, okay? How are you gonna deliver it? You know, like the syringes, okay, the needles. And then if you still use the traditional method of doing that, it's going to be a problem because you're going to have a lot of sharp waste. Okay, you have a lot of medical waste. And then the other thing is like when you talk about needles and syringes, you need professional people to do the administration. And now I can almost imagine like because like our body cleared the antibodies so fast that maybe a year we may need at least three times to get like this coronavirus shot, okay, at least three times. You can count the number of people in the world, correct? So in fact, we had been working with microneedles, okay, miniature needles, that is actually made out of glassy material so that you don't create any type of medical waste. So this is addressing bottleneck. And again, it's actually working with company, working with people that they would see the bottleneck. Where's the bottleneck in this supply chain, correct? Or on this value chain. So where can we actually make an impact? And that is important, okay? So
that's really good, very interesting point. I think you're right. Everybody's the race to the vaccine, but how do you deliver it is gonna be it's something we're gonna be coming across pretty soon. And so, But I think it, one of the things that I'm also curious with a partnership is the, you know, Hong Kong with China, and but how about in terms of the other partnership? Are there, you know, I think right now Hong Kong is in a really interesting place. I know UST has is working on a campus in southern China. So how do you see that the collaboration between Hong Kong and China in the near future or down the road?
In fact, as Hamilton mentioned, we do have a very strong working relationship with the Guangzhou State Key Lab under Chong Nansha that is stretched back to SARS, okay, SARS period, okay. Because we have been collaborating with them, because I'm an engineer. I'm not a virologist. I'm not a medical person. So we need the facility to study like viruses. In fact, I do send my student to their lab to do a lot of this testing for the technology. So this is kind of like long-term collaboration. We have been working with them for decades. Okay, So you can see a lot of my my interaction and relationship with company and with also with institution is actually very long term. So I'm playing the long game. I'm not playing the short game. Okay, in all of this, because the way that we look at it is like working in different discipline is very important, because like the one thing is like you get a new perspective on how to solve a problem. Because if you give a medical person to deal with this problem, they will give you a medical solution. If you give it to an engineer, they'll give you an engineering solution. If you give it to a biologist, they give you a biologist solution to the problem, okay? But nowadays, you cannot just have only a single perspective to solve a problem, okay? Because right now, problems are becoming more and more complex, more and more interconnected. So the point is that we need to do holistic. We need to do very interdisciplinary mindset. I would say interdisciplinary mindset beyond like saying working with people with different discipline, but actually to develop this interdisciplinary mindset, being able to see perspective from the other people's point of view, okay, in order to fully address the problem. I think that is very important. And working in companies is very important, because a lot of time I always joke with some of my colleagues, yeah, you make a disinfectant, it's really great. It kills everything, including the host, including the people, correct? Okay, yeah, it kills, okay? Or they would say, okay, you make something that is so great, okay, that is really great, but it's too expensive. Nobody's going to be able to afford it, correct? But that is the main thing. We need to have a full perspective in order to bring technology to the society, okay?
And this question coming from the audience, is, have you actually tested it on COVID-19 on its efficiency of this product?
In the presentation, we have been tested by third party, okay? And I think the official results should be coming very soon, okay? It's actually able to achieve 99.9%. Okay, against COVID-19, which is SARS-CoV-2, within 10 minutes. 10 minutes is the standard time frame for all third-party testing. Okay, so it has been tested.
I think you might have answered this before, but you said you're marketing the product for 90 days. But how long is it? Does it really? How long is it really effective?
Like for example, because I'm trained as an engineer, correct? One thing that you would see is for example, if you take a lift, the lift said it's for 10%. It doesn't mean that if you go one more person, it's going to break and then kill everybody. So usually we have what we know engineering safety factor. So we have a safety factor of 2. Okay. So that means to say it can last for 20 weeks, but we only claim for 90 days. Okay. So 20 weeks doesn't mean that it goes to 0. 20 weeks means the efficacy dropped to 70% reduction in 1 minute, okay? So that is our benchmarking, so.
And one of the things I saw in the FAQ on your website was, it was a really interesting question, and I also want to give our audience, I don't want to, it is still using it, you still need to let's see, what was the question? I think the audience should, using it doesn't mean you stop wearing the mask. You still need to take proper hygiene. This is just another tool to help, mitigate the problem, but it's still kind of what you, some of the basic rule still applies, mask wearing and all of that, correct?
Basically what it does is strengthen the protection, because this one is protecting against infection or transmission by touch. Okay, so you put it on surfaces to make sure that if somebody sneezes, you don't have to suddenly rush with disinfectant and try to clean it up. But it's still, whenever you have people in a place, okay, there's always the air transmission or direct contact transmission. Somebody can give you a pick on the cheek, right? Or even right now, they said somebody drop a tear on you, okay, because they find that tear contain a lot of viruses, okay? So this is basically trying to address one transmission route. And then, as I mentioned, the air filter is trying to address another transmission route, correct? Through the air, through the bioaerosol, okay? So these are basically technology that have been developed to try to mitigate different transmission routes.
And the question now is, what next for this product? I mean, I know we talked about the exports and all of that. What next in terms of research? Right now, it sounds like it's very effective. It sounds like the rest of the world really needs it, or in certain areas. But what next in terms of your research are you looking into? Sounds like we talked about earlier in terms of clothing and all that. But what other areas are you looking at, both of you, that the next stage? I mean, the virus is not, if it's not COVID, it's going to be other things. But what other things are you looking at in terms of?
In fact, MAP1 is the first of the series in this family, okay, of MAP, multi-level antimicrobial polymers. We are actually now in MAP3, okay, which is the third generation, okay. And then the third generation is used to address really, really difficult to disinfect viruses, okay, more than that of the coronaviruses. So this is basically a progression in terms of improvement of the technology, and also improvement in terms of the compatibility of the technology and safety of the technology. The other thing that we are doing a lot regarding MAP1 is working with the different stakeholder, industrial stakeholder, bringing it into fabrics like textile, taking this material and electrospinning it into mass material so that you can have a viral antiviral property. Using it, for example, as an additive in paint and epoxy, okay, so that you can actually extend it for a much longer term coating. And then we have been working with Hong Kong Drainage Services Department. We use the bactericidal property of the technology, okay, in order to prevent corrosion in the drainage infrastructure that is caused by bacteria. The same with waters and water supply department on their piping, okay, pipe work, because the pipe work also get contaminated by a lot of microorganism, and some of them can also chew up the tubing, okay, so this is also used on those. So the technology is actually quite expansive, because it can be easily added to many different products, okay, so you can use it in water filters, okay. In fact, the very first application of this technology is to be used in water filters, to be used in oil pipes, okay, in order to prevent corrosion in oil pipes. But then we extended this technology to other field of area, and this is culmination, because we thought the technology, why we make it this way, because we want it to be extremely flexible so that it can actually be an additive to other people's product or services, okay, and to provide added protection, okay. So that is the concept of this technology. I think Hamilton can also give you a little bit more outlook on that part.
Apropos to what Professor Yang just saying, we definitely mass is another area that we now looking into it, how we can add the MAT1 coating on the outer layer. The one just Professor Yang mentioned about is in the inner layer. So we are working together with some mass factory and also the raw material manufacturer. We try to come up with something that can adding these antiviral properties on the mask as soon as we can. So,
and one of the questions is, I'm not being a scientist. One of the things, could it be that is one of the problem too clean? Is that meaning that we always have to kind of be ahead of the curve? I mean, you know, there is a problem, you know, being too clean. I'm trying to. I don't know how to explain it, but could that be an issue as well? I mean, it sounds like that we are going to have to live in a bubble as human being and bacteria, you know, I think we've lived with bacteria and so on all our life, but it sounds like we're fighting it and then something happens and we keep on having to fight it. Is that potentially an issue as well?
Yeah, but for us, when you look at it from that point of view, it's like your immune system do need to be primed. Okay, that means to say you need to be exposed to some germs. Okay,
correct.
But the issue is like that is okay under normal circumstances. Correct. But very few people know. Like in the last decade, we have more than 300 emerging pathogens coming from the wild. Okay. So it's not really well publicized because some of them, like for example, Ebola almost took a foothold in the US, okay? And now you have the H1N1, and more recently they have been talking about like mystery virus in Kazakhstan, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And then and now you have hantavirus going on in Hong Kong, correct? You know, so this is always, we need to find a balance. How we wanted to do it, okay? So I'm not saying that all pathogens are bad, okay? But the main thing is like we need to find a balance in terms of like how we're gonna use the technology. So that's why we are not saying like, okay, you fully deploy it, okay, all the time. So that's why many of the technology that we also develop also have an exit clause, okay? If you don't want it, this is how you can use to remove it. Okay, so there's an exit clause for most of the thing. But for a lot of application, like for example, that we want for the drainage department, it's more related to how to prevent the consequence, okay, of a microbial attack or actions, correct? So that is one thing that we do look at. So I did ponder about it, correct? So this is something like the philosophy is like, why is it, like fully living in a bubble is a good thing or not. But I think at this moment in time, living in a bubble is not such a bad thing, correct? Okay,
so. Right, but you're right. I think this is just the reality of it, but some of us are craving to travel. I mean, we've talked about the government's talking about travel bubbles and some of us are planning on seeing families in the States for Christmas. So my question is quite practical. The advice, I'm definitely going to go out and find the product, but traveling, is there a way, are you working the product use on planes? I mean, it sounds like if it's going to be on buses, why not planes?
Yeah, Hamilton can give you some information on that.
So what airlines are you using it on? Because we really, I with a long weekend coming up here in Hong Kong, we know we're not going anywhere. We know the buses are clean and all that, but planes or other, give us Hamilton.
Okay, you bring out a very good question. And indeed, because we have some agreement signed in place, I can only say we actually don't work with particular airline, but we actually have some collaboration in place with the airplane manufacturer. So, but I just cannot disclose name, but there's only obviously two of them. We're working on that. We actually a very intensive meeting. We plan to bring this out a solution before the end of this year.
Right. I think right now, as much as I applaud the Hong Kong government and all the people here in Hong Kong, we're probably one of the safest place, along with New Zealand and Taiwan, in the world. But you can only stay in Hong Kong, 8 months without traveling. I think we're all edging, dying to travel somewhere. And so I think if the planes, like the buses, can be, made to fit to travel, I think, also the industries. I think the whole travel and tourism industry is devastated. In fact, I think we never thought when we started this webcast in February that it would last this long, and it's still not going anywhere in terms of dying off. We're hearing the second wave in Europe, and who knows how many waves in the U.S. and unfortunately in Latin America and all that. So I think it is truly a global pandemic like we've never seen in our lifetime. And it's really wonderful. I want to thank both of you for giving us this wonderful presentation and telling us more about this a product that is in some ways making our life a bit easier here in Hong Kong. And I hope in the future others will have an opportunity to also use it, because we're social animals. We do need to be with other people and collaborate. I think that's another interesting points that I take from this conversation, is how important collaboration is between industry and academics. Like Professor said, you can help solve the problem, but if people don't want the problem solved, I think industry comes in. And so it is really vital that, and in some ways, this also answers the question. A lot of time before, I remember pre-COVID, I think people were questioning the needs of research universities. I think other people who are maybe in the business sector with MBAs and so on. But I think the importance of research, basic research, and bringing that to fruition when the time, you never know. I think Chinese has a term, 临时抱佛脚. You don't worship at the Buddha's feet at the last minute. You really need to make the investments. And that's really important of education and collaboration. So I want to thank both of you for your wonderful insights and ensuring us that there is safety and there are products out there that we can use right now and is being used by in the public spaces. So I look forward to visiting the Science Museum and other museums, because I've been a proponent of opening the museums and as another place for the young people of Hong Kong who are still learning from home. Hopefully in a week or two, many of them will be back to school. And in schools also need products like this so that parents will feel safer sending their kids to school. So I want to thank you both. And I look forward to maybe welcoming you guys back to tell us more wonderful inventions that that will benefit those of us living in this current climate. And thank you both. And I want to thank all of you for joining us this morning for our COVID update, episode 29. And we are planning, as long as the COVID is with us, we will be continuing this series. We do not have one yet planned, episode 24, but my colleagues and I are working on it, and we look forward to welcoming you back so that we can alleviate some of your concerns, answer some of your questions about COVID. And also in the meantime, we look forward to welcoming you on Friday, September 25th, this week at 9 a.m. We're gonna talk about other issues, also kind of immediate, US, China, and Russia. We will have former ambassador, US ambassador to Russia, Professor Michael McFaul of Hoover Institute, joining us in discussion with our chairman, talking about US, China, and Russia. And right now, if you check on our website, we will have programs for every member of your family, whether from Asia Society Hong Kong or Asia Society Global. And don't worry, if you miss the broadcast or webcast live, you can always catch it a later time. So thank you all of us for joining us. And I also want to remind all of us, we're in this together, and some of these issues are going to be with us for a while, but we can solve it together, and importance of collaboration. So thank you. Thank you both to Hamilton and Professor Young for your presentation. And I look forward to welcoming all of you back online. And I look forward to welcoming you all back in person, and especially after I talk to Hamilton about using the product, so that Asia Society Hong Kong will be safe, a safe place for all to explore and to learn. So good morning. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.